for urban mobility, the conversion from ICEs to electrification at least will reduce the concentrated pollution. So what I would like to share is we are in an unprecedented situation, to say the least. A couple of months back, nobody thought that we would be sitting in the situation where the whole world, in fact, 188 countries in the world getting affected at one time. Absolutely unprecedented. And the new normal is happening very, very quickly, and we will have to adopt to the new normal. When I look at automotive industry in specific, the automotive industry, which was looking at about 88 million vehicles, now is staring at about 60 million as of now. We do not know whether it's going to drop even further. So it's high uncertainty right now, and everybody is looking what could be the recovery paths. It's not clear. To say that somebody knows about it is certainly false. It depends on two topics right now. One is the control of the virus itself as to how it's going to pan out, whether a vaccine is going to come or something is going to happen. And the second one is the creation of demand, which is very, very important. Be it for the IC engines or for electrification, whatever it is, the critical point now is the creation of demand. But from the market feedbacks that we have is what I would like to share. It is expected that electrification would recover faster than the ICEs, because ICEs is predicted to come back to the 2019 levels, perhaps in 2023. But electrification has got a lead here because it was still in the initial stages. So it is the time where it can catch up faster. And I will come to why with a few particular logics, which perhaps would throw light on this. See, ultimately for the penetration of electrification, it is very important to have a sustainable ecosystem. Now, let me try to clarify what I mean by this ecosystem. The ecosystem can be looked from different perspectives. It is basically the environmental perspective to begin with. The second one is the buyer perspective. The third one is the affordable technology, what it offers. The fourth one is the infrastructure. And the fifth one is basically policy consistency. I would just like to touch upon each one of them so that it gives an idea as to which segment of electrification perhaps finds it more favorable for this ecosystem and where the penetration can happen. Let me start with environmental perspective. COVID has shown, even though so much of adversity, that the pollution levels in the urban as well as in the other areas has significantly come down. It has given us a taste of a pollution-free city. Should we let this go post-COVID? Certainly not. So can we liberate some portion of this that we are going to come back in a different form, that we don't pollute the atmosphere as much as what we were doing before? So when the environmental situation is taken, it purely depends upon the energy mix of the country. If the energy mix is most tilted towards the fossil fuels, then the switch to electrification is not going to change so much, because we are moving the pollution from the exhaust to the chimneys. But at the same time, for countries like, say, Norway and France, where it is more of hydro and nuclear, we see that we call it into two situations, well-to-wheel and cradle-to-grave situation. Well-to-wheel is an operation. Well-to-wheel can yield almost 90% reduction in emissions of CO2, depending on the energy mix. The cradle-to-grave situation, which is more of the lifetime CO2 emission, it can come down by 50%. If I take India in specific, currently we're at about 17% of renewable energy in our energy mix. The government is focusing a lot in terms of putting more of renewables, and the estimates are by 2027, we would scale up to 35%. It's good news. Because the more of renewables, the switch to electrification will yield better for the environment. But one thing is sure, for urban mobility, the conversion from ICEs to electrification at least will reduce the concentrated pollution. So this is one positive part when I look from the environmental point of view. Second one, very important, is the buyer perspective. And I can tell you one thing. We may talk about environment, but when it comes to personal decisions, most often it goes, what do I benefit from this buy? Will my total cost of ownership come down? is my user experience going to be better by going in for an electrified vehicle? So this plays a significant role in what I mentioned in the first one is demand creation. We have seen from calculations that for four-wheelers, the total cost of ownership is still not workable when it comes to personal mobility. It takes almost 10 years for an equivalent car between an ICE and an EV to pay back. But shared mobility, of course, can be shorter. It can be about 3 years. But the good part is the light electromobility, be it the two-wheelers or the three-wheelers, the TCO benefits a lot and the payback period is less than 1 year. So this will be the trigger even post-COVID when safety and personal mobility becomes the choice because of the issues that we have with social distancing and the shared mobility will take a backseat and personal mobility takes prominence, there is a good chance that the light electromobility, particularly the two-wheelers and the three-wheelers, will find its resumption pretty quick back onto track. So this is on the buyer perspective. I moved next to the affordable technology. This has got a link to TCO. If the technology that is coming in is not affordable, it will lead to higher cost of acquisition. But we see today that with global R&Ds coming in, global means global technologies that are adopted for local conditions, where the product becomes fit to market and it is reliable and safe, clubbed with localization. This is a very, very important term because with the phased manufacturing program of the government, it becomes incentivized that local manufacturing and increasing the base for electrification will bring in more synergies into the system. And obviously cost is a direct function of scale. When the scale comes, the technology becomes more affordable. So this is something that we can work on as in the industry, and the industry has taken this very seriously, and I will talk a bit later about the policy where the FAME actually incentivizes not only the OEM, but also the suppliers to establish a strong manufacturing program. The next one when I move is the infrastructure. This is where the light electromobility has an advantage. It doesn't require a great infrastructure where later you will see with Quark U as well. The modular nature of the construction makes it so simple, it can be charged in the house. For the four-wheelers, we require a big infrastructure, otherwise there is range anxiety, which we do not have in the two-wheelers. So this makes it favorable in terms of the infrastructure that we can straight away start with the change of ICEs into electrification in this segment. The last one, and then I stop, is basically the policy consistency or continuity. The FAME is a very good incentive system. If you look at the way it is formed, actually, it is the right one for India because it incentivizes 1 million of two-wheelers. It incentivizes 500,000 of three-wheelers. And it is the right one because if we get into this segment, which already has got a good TCO, and the government further promotes it, it is like the flywheel effect. Once you start the flywheel, it's difficult to start, but once started, it's difficult to stop. So this is the flywheel effect that it creates in order to bring in a momentum for electrification. In fact, for two-wheelers, October is the postponed deadline by which the FAME initiative kicks in so that 1 million vehicles can be incentivized to get into the field quicker. So policy consistency is very important. So what I would like to look at this, and also in other panel discussions I mentioned this, FAME 2 is a fantastic situation we are in to capitalize, but what next? So the government can think that it can have a continuity of policy where the investments which are to be put by the industry, they're also encouraged to put this because there is continuity of policy. So overall, when I look at all these five put together as the ecosystem, electrification is sure to pitch in. And it's going to start from the light electromobility, particularly the two-wheelers and the three-wheelers, which creates the flywheel effect so that the supplier base is well set up. And the customers start to experience the thrill and the use of electrification. And then, of course, the four-wheelers will follow and then the heavy-duty vehicles next. But this is the initiation of the revolution to follow. So this is what I would like to mention, that for electrification, it's a situation that we can get into the new normal with a faster penetration of electrification, particularly in the light electromobility.